If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump.
Oh, I put you guys on the hot seat for just a quick minute there about daddy daycare.
I don't want to think about that stuff.
I know you guys both got a little nervous talking about that stuff.
So for about 42 minutes, we have some nice conversation. We talk about the largest aquariums in the world. I took my kids to the Monterey Aquarium. We talk about country music.
Sal was wrong, by the way, and that just you guys will see.
Yeah, I was almost.
It wasn't top five, bro.
I was almost wrong. Almost right,
Mr. Though. Google failed today.
We talk about country music, and Adam says how he likes to go there because of all the hot girls.
Way to go. We have rolled under the bus, Dick.
We get the update on Justin's chickens after that debacle that happened earlier.
Hashtag productivity.
And then we get into a kind of a heated discussion about the pluses and minuses of putting your kids on social media. We also announce our flash sale, which I talked about, which I talk about at the end of the episode as well. If you want to get information about that flash sale, you have to register for the 30 days of coaching, which is at mindpumpmedia.com. And then we talk about our Organifi contest that we were coming up with. So I think what we decided was people, if you go on Instagram.
Maybe someone gives us a good idea. I like to see.
You want to keep it open?
Yeah, let's keep it. We're not gonna nail it down yet. We'll definitely put it out there later on. Let's find out.
We're going to give shit for free.
We want to give away some free Organifi supplements. So give us some suggestions. I guess they should email admin@mindpumpmedia.com with your suggestions on how you can win an Organifi supplement. And then we get into the questions. The first question was,
did you tell where people could go if they actually want to Organifi right now?
That's great. Thanks, Adam. It's Adam, Organifi.
I'm Adam. That's Justin. My bad. Doug is right over there.
It's OrganifiShop.com.
Just call him Austin.
And also, you can use the code MINDPUMP for a massive discount. And let's get into the questions. The first question was, what styles of CNS training could you do in replace of trigger sessions? For example, isometrics or plyometrics. Then we talk about working the floor as a personal trainer. Many of your clients can come from the actual people working out in the gym on the floor. We talk about some of the techniques on how to approach them and how to make that happen.
Adam works the pole.
That's right. Might be a good idea to hang out in the parking lot, see who drives up in the $100,000 whip.
Yep, and sound like a douchebag. Then we could talk about if you have clients with eating disorders, what you can do to help them and who you should send them to. And finally, Justin's been in a band before. Does Mind Pump compare to being in a band? He thinks it does. He talks about it in that particular question. And finally, this month, you can get access to our private forum for free. There's about 2,000 members on there, personal trainers, fitness professionals, myself, Adam, and Justin. We're on there every single day. You can get access for free if you enroll in any MAPS program or any MAPS bundle, including our super bundle, which is 1 year's worth of exercise programming. And also, don't forget, the price goes up in September. You can find all of that at mindpumpmedia.com.
All by myself. Yeah, I'm all by myself. They all left me. But the good news is people left a lot of reviews. In fact, we got 46 reviews this last week, and I'm going to give away 12 t-shirts. So take that, Sal, Adam, and Justin. All right, our winners are Jackie0721, RosieRail10, AmazingMe0311, Kendon Shaw, Jazz Massa, Junior Swam, Pime0965, Dudley Two Right, Joey Bag of Donuts, Joe Brendel, F. Surik88, and Being the Best Colin. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Welcome to the Sal and Adam Show,
where we talk shit about Justin,
who's not plugged in or on the show. So anyway, Adam, you ever seen somebody with paler skin than Justin?
Mm-mm.
Yeah.
Never.
Oh, he's here. Oh. Hey, Justin. How you doing, buddy?
What's up, you bastards?
Hey, Justin.
Yeah.
You have a very rugged, handsome look to your face.
I know that.
It's, huh?
Yeah.
You're aware of it?
For sure.
You're not supposed to say that, bro. You're supposed to be like, oh, thank you for that. You're supposed to be like, oh, thank you for that compliment. Not be like, you know what I mean?
What'd you guys do this weekend?
No, I own that.
Hmm?
What'd you do this weekend? you have your kids or no?
I do. I had my kids this weekend. I have them all week. I took took them to the Monterey Bay Aquarium, one of my favorite places on earth.
Really?
Oh, I love it there.
Oh, wow.
I love it.
You know what's funny? It's way smaller than it's one of those things. Remember when you were a kid that you used to go to and you're like, oh, it was so big and amazing? I went there like maybe a year or two ago and I had been there in probably 20 years.
It's kind of lost its luster for
me too. Totally. Yeah. It's like, I was like, this feels like an aquarium in somebody's house, dude. This is like a tiny little thing, dude.
It's still one of the biggest aquariums in the world, but it's you can walk the whole thing
right
now.
Really?
Yeah.
It's considered one of the biggest aquariums in the world?
In the world. It's one of the largest aquariums in the world.
Wow.
It is. I think it might even be top five. I don't know. We should find out.
Wow. Hmm. Doug, Google that. Top five aquariums in the world.
So like Monterey Bay Aquarium and then put biggest aquarium in the world and see what pops up. I love it there. I absolutely love it because it's just fascinating. I find so many of their...
What's your favorite? The jellyfish or the big tank?
So I love the jellyfish.
Yeah.
They're just...
One of my favorites.
They're weird.
Yeah.
It's just a weird, aliens. It's a weird organism. Yeah. Like that it's almost all water. You know that, right? Jellyfish are like almost no mass to them whatsoever. And yet they float around and like move their tentacles. It's pretty crazy.
What do they feed off of? Bacteria? What do they feed off of?
Plankton. They eat lots of plankton.
Phytoplankton or whatever.
Yeah, and then my daughter loses her mind for the sea otters.
Oh, really?
Yeah, just loses her.
Because they're too cute or what?
They look like little, let's be honest.
They got little, like, beards.
They look like little teddy bears in the water. Yeah. They're fucking adorable.
Little teddy bears.
They look like little teddy bears if you look at them. And you know when they sleep together, if two of them sleep next to each other, they hold hands so that they don't float away from each other?
That's just ridiculous.
That's just too, it's too adorable.
Too much. Yeah.
A
shark needs to eat them to regulate.
No, dude, no.
It's too cute.
Oh, it's number survive. It's the sixth largest aquarium in the world.
Oh, see, not top five. Wrong.
Damn.
Wrong again, Sal.
You know what's cool about...
I got you, motherfucker.
You know what's cool about...
I knew it wasn't top five.
If I'm wrong, though, I'm always just wrong. It's never like very wrong. It's always just wrong. What's the number one biggest... Oh, you're scrolling down. Let's find out. I bet it's in China. How much you want to bet it's in China or somewhere in the Middle East, in Dubai? Oh, Dubai, second place.
Dubai, of course.
What's first place?
They get all the money
dun,
there.
Dun, dun, dun. Mm. Oh, in Georgia? Is that in Georgia, like America?
I did not expect that.
Atlanta. Wow, I didn't know they had the biggest...
I've been to the water. I think
we'll
have to put that
on a list if we ever
tour
out there. Do we have any podcasters out in Atlanta, Georgia?
In Atlanta?
Do we?
I don't know.
I don't think so.
What goes on out there?
I don't know anybody.
Casino
in the
out
ATL.
There. A cool casino and aquarium. I'm down to go out there just for those two reasons.
I'm down.
Do they still make good hip hop music? Or are they done now? I'm looking at you, Adam, because you're always on the up and up.
Yeah, where's the hot spots?
Well, I'm not that much on the up and up where I know where these guys are born, dude. I don't know if who's. I'm sure, dude. Because
it was a thing for a while, right? It was East Coast, then West Coast, and then
you're thinking of Nelly.
Atlanta had they had more than that, didn't they?
Hotlanta.
Yeah, no. I mean, that whole crew that was attached to Nelly is all from that area.
What's his name? What's that little dude with
the dirty South
with the big, he sounds like he's a big guy, but he's not. He's a little guy.
Little guy.
Ja Rule.
Oh, Ja Rule.
Wasn't he from there?
I don't know. He might be from there.
I haven't thought about that guy.
Neither have I. That was a good one, right?
Wow. Hey, you remember the first time
pulled
seeing
that one out, resurrected that one out.
Remember the first time you saw him? You're like, that guy makes that voice?
Yeah,
no, he's
can't even emulate.
He's
it.
Tiny, dude.
It's like the lead singer of Pantera. Wasn't he a little guy, too?
Phil Anselmo. Yeah. I don't think, I mean, he wasn't that big.
Yeah. But you hear these guys' voice and you expect.
Oh, yeah. He was an angry dude. That's for sure.
You know, a lot of like famous actors, singers, a lot of them are really short.
Yeah.
It's really common. A lot of times in movies, Hollywood shoots like special angles to make them look bigger than life when they're really these tiny little men.
Yeah. Well, Tom Cruise. I feel like that was on a stilt.
This was right. This was like God's way of balancing things out. Like, you got the short end of the stick with the height and the stuff. You're not very manly, but we're gonna make you super fucking famous.
But then like Thor, that guy that plays Thor, I think he's like 6'2" or 6'3".
Well, he's a stud.
So he's you know. Then there's those guys.
Is he more of a stud than the guy that plays Superman, Henry Cavill?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, what else has Henry Cavill done?
What do you mean?
Like, what's his body of work?
I don't Superman. Know. What else has Thor done?
A bunch.
Oh, he's done a bunch of shit. Yeah, he's been in quite a few movies.
Yeah. Well, Star Trek. But I'm saying if you put him next to each other, you know what? So there's that scene in Superman where Henry Cavill has a
totally
beard.
Different guys, though, too. You're talking about
They're both
blonde
good.
Hair, blue eyed versus
like
the tall, dark, handsome, right?
Yeah.
I lean towards the opposite of what I, you know, we're
We've
tall.
Talked about this before.
Yeah, yeah, we have talked about this before. Yeah, so I like the blonde hair, blue eye guys.
That's more my thing.
Yes.
Yeah. I got a taste for it. Yeah.
But I feel like Doug would like the tall, dark, and handsome guy.
Oh, you think? Yeah.
Just because he's.
Just because the way he responds.
Just because I was his trainer?
Yeah.
I see.
He trained with me. What did you guys do? Didn't you go to a concert or something like that?
I did. Yeah,
did you end up going?
I went and saw Sam Hunt. First
if you
time
say that fast, it might be interesting.
No, it's his brother Mike.
Oh,
no,
Mike. Yeah, that's yeah. right. Thank you, Sal. Mike
Sam Thompson. Hunt yeah. is part of this R&B meets country music phenomenon that's been going on for the last probably 5 to 8 years, if I'm guessing. That's
Whoa,
just
what does that
out.
Sound like?
I actually like it, and a lot. And so, if you're a country purist, you don't like it. Like, so you hate on it. It reminds me of, like, remember when Limp Bizkit came on scene and the whole rap Kid Rock. A lot of people don't like that. I am drawn to talent. Period. Like, yeah. I listen to all types of music. I don't think there is a kind of music that I don't listen to.
I like to actually be challenged musically.
Right.
You know? And get outside my comfort with it.
It was actually fucking really good, man. And I'm not like a diehard country
listener. Is it like upbeat or is it slow?
Very upbeat. It's like hip-hop meets country.
Hmm.
It's very he looks like if Will Smith had a baby with George Strait.
Mm.
So that's what his like music is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's he's got swag. He runs the stage pretty well. I had a great
Is
time.
It a country crowd or is it hip hop?
You
crowd?
Remember Aaron country Lewis crowd. From Stained?
Yes.
So he's like full country now and I love
Right.
His
so
shit.
He you know that he originally was a country guy and then
went rock.
They pushed him towards rock because they felt that he would be able to make a name for himself easier going that direction.
Mm-hmm.
But country is his and I love his country actually. So he's somebody really who I
just
do
can't
like.
I can't get into country. I just
Why?
Can't. I don't know why. Just my girlfriend listens to it. She loves it and I listen to it and it's
Do you like Johnny Cash?
Johnny Cash, I do. Johnny Cash, I can do.
That's always the first go to. If I ever somebody always gives me that, like I hate country. Like, oh, you like Johnny Cash, and you can kind of progress in that direction.
As a really young kid,
were you guys exposed to it?
Yeah, I was later on, but as a young kid,
I hated it when I was younger.
So did I. Yeah. As a really young kid, I hated it. But like most things that I hated as a young kid, it was because I hadn't really truly experienced it. Right, I had maybe one or two experiences with it and turned it. You know, I don't like it. But it's like. When I got into high school, towards the end of high school, like junior, senior year, and I worked on the ranch, it was playing all the time. So there was, you know, everybody I worked with listened to country. I'm driving a tractor, I have hay in my mouth. It just seemed appropriate to be listening to country and not fucking Nelly.
Not
right?
A nice dip in your mouth.
Yeah, yeah, all that good stuff. So yeah. The small phase
makes
of
me puke every
attempting
time,
to chew was man. During that time also.
You tried to chew?
For like a short minute. Very short minute.
What did you chew?
What was it? Huh? Copenhagen?
I tried all of it. And I tried the little bags too. Like I did, you know.
Oh, it's too strong.
Yeah.
Every time I
tried. I tried a handful of times. And then when I realized that I was trying really hard, that I was like, okay, this is not a good
I really want this in my life. You know, come on.
So hold
I want
on.
Mouth cancer.
This is a great topic because I feel like everybody that gets into those habits tried to get that habit first. I don't think anybody ever smokes their first cigarette.
It doesn't
cigarette.
Come easy.
Yeah, I don't think anybody smokes their first cigarette or does their first chew and is like, this is fucking great.
Yeah, no.
I bet everybody's like, ah. And like, they're like, oh, no, no.
Ah.
Keep doing it for about a week and then you'll like it.
I can't speak on anybody else's experience, but my experience with, you know, tobacco in that sense, like as far as cigarettes, chew, all that, every one of those things that I attempted and tried, none of them were love at first sight. It was like a... You know, I'll keep trying it because I want to be cool. You know, it was at that age. It's like I'm doing it because I want to be cool and feel cool. Because back then it kind of was. Now it's totally different, right? Like now the generation coming up, you're like, oh my god, why would you do that? It's disgusting.
Yeah.
But our generation, it was still we still were a part of the
where it was cool.
Marlboro Man was still the man.
But that's what I mean. I feel like I don't think anybody ever does it and then loves
what
it right
did we
away.
Just meet? Who did we just meet that was related to the Marlboro Man?
Marlboro Man?
Know. Yeah, I just met somebody. Who did we just... I just met somebody. Who, yeah, I just met
somebody. Came in here. I think I know who you're talking about.
I don't remember who... Remember
you want to talk about an advertising faux pas with that guy, huh? When he got lung cancer?
Well,
that was horrible for them.
Supposedly...
Yeah, stick with the cartoon.
Supposedly, he was a fucking stud. Yeah. And I don't remember who was connected. Anyways, whatever. But I went to Sam Hunt. Sam Hunt was... I also had Kendrick Lamar tickets, which I gave them away to
Now, what kind of music's that?
That's hip-hop.
Okay.
Yeah. And Kendrick Lamar, I've seen already.
I'm officially an old fucker.
He puts on a badass show, and I know the audience is listening. Is probably like giving me shit. Would give me shit if they found out that I passed on Kendrick Lamar and I went to Sam Hunt, because it was I'm too old to do back to back concerts. I didn't get that in me. So by one night of staying out till fucking 11 midnight and partying like that's just I can't.
So Sam Hunt was a country crowd.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I heard this is not the rumor but the stereotype of country crowds that it's the hottest girl.
Oh, not even close, brother. The way beyond, like the best concert you've ever been to on like any other genre, like country smashes on it.
Yeah. Everybody says
beautiful women everywhere.
Everybody says that.
They just come out of everywhere.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
I think that's a prereq for hot chicks. Like you have to listen to country music. I think that's just part of it.
They like grow them there.
They do. You know. Yeah, so Shoreline was covered in beautiful women, great music. It was a great crowd.
Covered.
Yeah, all over the place.
Just
everywhere.
Blanketed.
Yeah.
Sea of vagina. Yeah.
Beautiful, glorious.
But I didn't go to Kendrick Lamar. We gave the tickets to the boys here. Like sent Taylor.
T-Dog.
T-Dog.
Did he take draw with him?
He didn't, actually.
We need to get them like necklaces, you know, so they can go to these concerts.
Drew was really upset that he didn't go because he wanted to go, but he didn't stay past 4 o'clock on Friday for work, dude. That was the deal. Was this the tickets were for the guy who puts in work? The
we haven't, you know, what we haven't done yet. We haven't like hazed them. Well,
that was kind of a little haze right there.
Nah, yeah, but you know, like a real one. Like let's take it back 40 years.
If you are
beat him up or something.
If you're a kid right now, he's 20 years old. If you're a 20-year-old kid or 19,
robe.
And you're a diehard Kendrick Lamar fan and you missed out on tickets to the suite to watch Kendrick Lamar because you don't work very long. That's fucking digging on him a little bit. It's digging on him a little bit. Dude.
A little bit.
I think he was a little upset about that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Teach him to work longer though.
Hey Justin, how's your chickens?
You know what?
Is it all good now?
Super, super productive.
Really?
Very, very. The very next day, every single one of them laid eggs inside the coop.
Oh my God.
The very next morning. And it's been that way consistently.
You know what? This is such an example.
Dude, let me tell you something.
Of life.
Let me tell you something. This was like a profound display of like psychology. You know, like it was like this. Just watching that, I was like, wow, it's so primitive, but like you could make so many metaphors and parallels from that.
This is how humans work too.
Yeah.
You know how many times I would get a team, I'd manage a team, and it was like I'd do my best, but there was that one person.
Bad apple.
And you just know like.
Gotta get rid of him, he'll poison the rest of the team.
Yeah, you can't rehab him. You just have to cut the cancer out.
You just
gotta snap his neck, man.
You gotta snap his neck in front of everybody else, and then everybody straightens right up.
I had one situation
nice and loving, and none of them squawking.
So I had one situation where that actually happened. And I can't obviously name names, but I told you this story when we were in L.A. When I got Hillsdale, when they re-grand opened, they put me in there.
Mm-hmm.
I had this one sales guy in there who had been with the company forever. And he was one of those old dinosaurs that was just, he wasn't old himself, but he was a dinosaur in the sense that he had that old mentality, didn't want to change, was kind of abrasive. You know, he did what I told him, but kind of didn't at the same time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like he was above the law type of thing. Well, man, that fucker... He used to party in the gym, and one day, I don't know what drug he took, and he took a shirt off and was running through the gym. And I was like, you're fired. Thank you for this opportunity to get you the fuck out of my gym.
Yeah.
It was so much better after that. So much better after that.
I don't know, man. I feel like that, it had a lot of impact on me, mainly because, like, it's something that, like, it's uncomfortable, right? It's like, I talked about this, about my process kind of leading up to that fact, but like
the chicken murder.
Yeah. But it's like, you know, like I look at that on a deeper level and like just as like a visual example for me that I needed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, I know.
It was powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody's safe.
I didn't even smoke. You know what I
mean? You know, I hiked on Sunday. We went up to Castle Rock. You been up there?
I told you about Castle Rock.
Oh, so you've been up there.
I think, was I the one that recommended you guys? We've been there now like three times.
Oh, really? Okay. So
I love Castle Rock. What a great place.
Yeah. The only thing that sucked for me is my allergies as you're going through like the kind of, it was beautiful though. It was a great hike.
Did you boulder? Did you do the bouldering?
No, I didn't do any of that. We just went and we did the one, two, three, like the third or fourth challenging trail down. Like, I think it was...
I know what you're talking about. That's the one we did.
It felt like... I think it said 1.3 to 2.5 hours. I'm like, okay, that's cool.
Yeah. You know? How about the views when you got to the top?
Yeah, no, beautiful. I took some shots while I was up there. It was just gorgeous up there.
What a great hike.
You know, I had some thought. I always get... like about the hikes, too, is it really does... gives me these random thoughts. And I had this thought that I wanted to ask you guys when I had you guys together, because I'm not a father. You know, we've been talking a lot lately, and we have today, we have Tom Bilyeu coming in with the neuroscientist for Modius, the company Modius, and we're going to talk to them about this great tech tool and everything. And I've been thinking a lot about that since I've been reading this book, Irresistible, and I was talking to Andy about his book, Unplugged, and having him over here. And so this has been on my mind a lot, and I was thinking, you know, and I have some friends that are... you have kids that they actually started their Instagram really, really young. And they already have young, and they already have like 3,000-4,000 followers. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I was thinking about this, like, and I know what's happening right now.
They're
with
building their currency.
Well, exactly. So this is where I wanted to say something to you guys and hear your thoughts on this. And before you knee jerk and just react, I want you to like really think about this, that, okay, do we believe, and I do, that the future of, you know, hiring somebody, that their social presence is going to be a major factor on whether they get a job or not because of how much? Because if somebody has got 5,000 or 10,000 people following them, obviously they have the ability to influence. They're somewhat of a leader, whether it be good or bad, doesn't matter. They've got people that are following them, right? Would make them a leader in some respects. And then you have these companies that are looking for these type of people. And I think we're going to see more and more of that in the future as a prereq to get a job at some places. Yeah. And I wonder if, you know, as a parent, you think, oh, my God, I don't want to do that right now. But are we helping them more, or are we hindering them more?
I look at it. OK, I'll answer it this way, I guess. I look at it like Warren Buffett kind of treats his kids. Like, he's got like an endless supply of capital for them in any pursuit they ever wanted to go into. But he's very restrictive, and for a reason. He wants them to have their own experience. He wants them to build their own disciplines, build their own character, go through the same trials and tribulations, you know, that he got to where he got. And I think that... I think that you can make an argument that like it'll make their life easier by, you know, aggregating all these like Instagram followers or whatever the social platform is at the time. And, you know, like you could look at it like currency, like I'm building up like a savings plan, or like this is like a 401k or something at that point. Right. And I don't know. I guess I come from a different place with that, in that I less for me. Like, I know it's going to be an inevitability, because that's how people are going to interact. You know, they're already doing that like face to face, like they're interacting through their phones, which is crazy, but it's just something that, you know, it's new, and we're all going to have to kind of grow with it and see where it all goes. But, I want to kind of pull the reins a bit with that. Until like they can make, you know, their own, like, it's, you know, later on when you deem like it's appropriate, right?
Now, when you say that, do you struggle with that process? Like, do you feel like you kind of go back and forth, like, fuck,
mm-hmm.
you know, like you're saying it right now, but then I feel like, did you ever, was that just a decision and you made that? Or is it like, fuck, should I not?
Yeah, no, I thought along, you know, along those lines, because, you know, like me and Sal talked about this too, about exposure even for kids and all the predators that, you know, this endless sea of like predators that are just there, you know, at a whim. And like, how much information are we really wanting to put out there of our private lives?
So many different questions pop up for me with that, and so many different feelings.
Mm-hmm.
And I try to be as objective as possible. And the things that
which is hard when you're the parent, by the way.
That's right.
That's why I wanted to challenge him.
But not only that, but not only are we parents, but we're also social media. We have a large social media presence, and we have a large podcast presence. So it's different for my kid than it would be for someone else. Like,
yeah.
You know, if you're, you know, a celebrity, I'm not one of these big celebrities. Let's say you're Tom Cruise. Like, putting your kid out there is very different than
what sparked this. So I have friends that would be considered that, you know, like NFL stars or, you know, celebrity type people where they have huge followings. They've started their kids and their kids now have thousands of followers and stuff.
So I wonder first, number one, who the fuck is following these little kids? How old are the kids? Do you know?
Yeah, they're like, they look to me like they're somewhere around 9 to 11 years
right.
old.
So somewhere. Who's following a 9-year-old's social media page? It's not a bunch of 9-year-olds, or maybe it is, maybe not. One thing that we're starting to realize now with the internet is that the dark side of the internet is massive. It's huge. There are countless pages that are created where they're like hubs for pedophiles, and they'll do stuff like.
Now you're gonna say that, and this is me just totally playing devil's advocate and challenging your thought process to help you be more objective, because on this show you've multiple times you've said that we live in the safest time we've ever lived in. And, you know, that to me, when you say something like that, it sounds almost like a parent who's like, there's no way I would let my kids stay outside and play past dark because it's so dangerous outside. But is it really more dangerous?
So if you're first off, I just like the thought of feeding that with my kid. So whether nothing happens to them or not, I don't like the thought of it. So it just bothers me. But the second thing is, if you have some type of celebrity and your kid is out there, that is a place that can, that's where someone can target you. And we've seen that happen in the past, and the odds are still small. But even besides all that, forget all that. Like, I don't know, man. What kind of currency are they building with a following from being a 9-year-old? Like, what are they doing?
Well,
I feel like a lot of people are following because they're fans. Hold on, because they're fans of their parents. And it's just more of this, like, I'm doing everything for my kid. You know, type of attitude and mentality. When you know, kids need to kind of be kids a little bit sometimes, and posting their picture out on social media. That's some of my feelings behind it. Like, what is that going to really build for them? And like, Justin.
Well, let's
said,
talk
like,
about that. And I've thought about this. This is why I wanted to bring it up. Is, you know, I imagine the roles are reversed, and I have a dad or a mom who's somewhat of a celebrity, or they have a large following, and they start my Instagram page when I'm 7 years old or whatever. And now I'm in, you know, fourth and fifth grade and interacting with other kids, and I have a 3,000 or a 5,000 following. I would think that kid probably has a much easier time making friends and is probably going to start off pretty damn popular right away because, and so you could argue.
So creepy to think about. I just see that as like, no, I see like popularity by following, right? So that's like a new metric that kids are going to like totally respond
absolutely.
To.
And so if you're crazy. Wait, hold on, let me finish here because you're already trying to challenge it. And I'm trying to tell you right now that this is the part that maybe you haven't thought all the way through is, and you holding them from it. Let's say you're a parent who's like, absolutely not. Till my kid is a certain age, they're not going to be able to do these type of things. And because of that, you've now pigeonholed your kid as the less, he's not going to be cool and he's not going to have any friends because he doesn't even have a social presence at all. And popularity this will be another
standard.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Another standard that people will use as if you're cool or not cool as a young kid growing up. And as a father, am I, you know, by telling them no, they can't because of my own fears of, you know, them predators looking at them or doing these things, that I'm not allowing him to build a social following that could potentially make his school life a little bit easier and popularity.
Okay, so we're talking about a 9-year-old because that's the age that you gave.
Well,
so.
No, I mean, it could be any age. It doesn't need to be. Those are semantics.
Okay,
you don't
whatever.
Need to get
it's
into
a
that.
Kid. It's a kid.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay,
it's
so let me
kid.
Ask you guys this. Let me ask you this, Adam. How well do celebrities that are kids, celebrity kids, not kids of celebrities, but celebrity kids, how well do they do in life typically later on?
Well, in the past, we have definitely had a lot of those types of kids that end up getting hooked on drugs and have all kinds of issues.
That's right.
So,
that's right. So having putting your kid out there, let's say you do a great fucking job. Now your kid gets 1 million followers on Instagram. Did you do them a favor? I think there's two sides to this that we need to look at, and we need to be very careful with it. And I think, like, if you're a parent, you do it with your kids, you're not hurting them, that's fine. That's totally up to you. I just think, like, I'm not just going to look at the positive, I'm going to look at the potential negatives.
Well,
and
of course.
If I'm a 10-year-old, look, I remember when I was 10, 11, 12, 13, with my insecurities, if I was out on social media with all these people watching me, I don't have the maturity Like, it's a struggle now. I'm a 38-year-old man putting my shit out on social media, having people watch me and comment on my stuff. I couldn't imagine being a 13-year-old with a troll being like, your legs are small, or you're ugly, or you're stupid, or I don't like what you're saying, or your page is dumb, or whatever. Like, you're putting your kid in a position where we've never been in this situation before.
Well, that's why it's fun to speculate about, because I don't think any of us in this room could be right or wrong. I think that you bring up incredibly valid points about this that are definitely concerns. But I was, again, I'm always trying to challenge the way I think about things, and I would 100% agree with you guys on the way you feel. But then I've also think, like, I never thought of it from the other side, like being a kid growing up and maybe my dad doesn't let me have those things. And now I'm at a school where I'm trying to make friends and be cool, and nobody thinks I'm cool because my dad doesn't let me have an Instagram and everybody else does. And this kid's.
Well, it hasn't happened yet, but look, I tell you what, there's a lot of things that make you cool in school that good parents will tell you no. Okay. It's just a lot of things. Like, even when we were kids, there were things that, you know, if you didn't do it, you weren't cool like everybody, but your parents made a smart decision by not letting you do those types of things.
Well, what are you thinking of? Like,
oh, anything. Drugs, buying you a shit ton of clothes.
Yeah, I think that's a bad comparison.
Hey, you know, like not having all the best clothes all the time, or having an awesome car. Like, you know, buy your kid a BMW right away just because it makes them cool.
Okay, so yeah, the clothes would probably be a better parallel, I think. Yeah. That's fair, like stylish clothes.
And the other thing that you gotta think about...
It'd be like you know, being a parent who doesn't allow your kid to buy...
That's right, and there's a big difference, too, we need to look at. Why are these people following your kid? Mm-hmm. Is it because they're cute? Because that, I think, is stupid. I think that's horrible. I think that's a horrible way to have a child identify with their value. Is your 9-year-old a musician? Are they creating something?
Yeah, but
are they creating a business? That's fine. I think that's awesome.
Is the answer, though, to not allow them to do it, or is it kind of teach them and educate them? Because eventually they're going to be a part of it no matter what.
Oh, shit. If my 9-year-old, if my kid is 9, and my kid's like, Dad, I got this idea for a business, or I want to play the guitar, and I want to put it on social media or whatever, like, that's different. If it's like, I'm cute, I'm just going to post pictures of myself and whatever, and get all these followers. Like, there's no doubt in my mind, and I don't know the situation, but if you're a child of a celebrity and you have 10,000 followers, I'm sure a lot of the people following you is because they're fans of your parents. Mm-hmm. And then they're following you for what? Like, just to look at you, to see, like, do you do anything of value? You know, when you look at celebrities, you can see the celebrities that did a good job with their kids and the ones that didn't. And a lot of times, the ones that did a bad job are the ones that put their kids out all the fucking time. Look at some of these dysfunction among some of these children. Then look at some of these kids. Like, whether you like or hate Donald Trump, his kids, he did a fucking great job. Like, they're very smart business people. He did a good job raising them in that particular sense. Arnold Schwarzenegger's got children that you don't hear a whole lot about as well. They tend to be more balanced and more functional. Then you've got other parents where kids are, they blast them all over the place. Mm. And that's tough for a kid to grow up in. I mean, most child psychologists will tell you, like, putting your kid in modeling, putting your kid in commercials, TV, movies, like,
yeah,
that's a very scary situation.
I also think that I think you're overgeneralizing a lot of things right now. And I think that comparing modeling and those type of stuff to social media, which has become a much different norm, and you have to understand that we were part of a generation that didn't have that and then now has it. So we have a different kind of perspective than somebody who is born into that, like at your kid's age, where, you could potentially be denying something that's just so normal to them. It's not like, what these examples that you're giving right now. Those are more extreme examples, when this is just simply, Dad, I just want to be on Instagram and be able to.
Yeah, it's a tough one, man, because normal,
everybody's going to have their own approach. At the end of the day, I think what makes us, more comfortable is, being able to restrict that as much as possible until they have more of an adult type of a brain to deal with that kind of attention.
Yeah, and normal is a shitty metric. Yeah. It's just a shitty fucking metric.
Yeah,
like, when people say
I agree with that.
It's normal. Everybody's doing it. We need to shut up with that bullshit. I hate that shit when people say it, because normal is eating garbage food, is fucking sitting down on your ass all day long. It's being these are things that were normal when we were kids.
Yeah, but as a child's mind, I'm speaking from a child's perspective when I say something like that. I agree with you.
Yeah, they're going to have to deal with it. Like, you're going to have to deal with your dad that tells you, I'm sorry that everybody's doing that shit, but I'm going to place certain parameters. And you have to be careful, obviously, with those types of parameters. But there's a lot of things that are normal that are just terrible that kids do. And I'm going to be in the minority, and it sucks because it's unfortunate that the minority of parents are parenting a certain way, and that a majority are parenting another way. It's just, I'll tell you what, man. Go look at the average kid's school lunch and look what they pull out of their backpack. It's a bag of gummy bears and a bag of Ritz crackers
and buy it.
And it's shit. And it's that's normal.
No doubt. I mean, now you're taking it a different direction and compared to different things. I think just simply asking yourself, like, could I actually, as much as I think I am protecting or helping them, could I, and ask yourself this, could I potentially be hurting him or her more by not allowing them to start something that could, like Justin said earlier, it's like this investment that they could be, you're making.
Now,
see,
I'm with you on that. Yeah. And I think the smart thing to do would be to sit down, honestly, and I've already thought about this, is to sit down with my kid, my son just turned 12, and to say, hey, let's sit down and come up with some ideas. Mm-hmm. I've already been talking to him. So this is a conversation I've already been having with my son. Not because he's begged me to go on these platforms, but I've explained to him what a sales funnel is on the internet. I've explained to him how people do business on the internet. I've explained to him how these pages on Instagram, pages on Facebook, and on YouTube make money. In fact, we had a conversation in the car yesterday on the drive to the aquarium where he was saying, he came up with an idea. And he's like, oh, you know how much you can make money on YouTube? And he came up with this idea. And he says, you'll get millions of views and that's how you make money. And so we sat down and I said, okay, and he understands advertising. That's how he thinks people make money on YouTube. He's like, advertising. I said, yeah, it's one way, but you need a ton of views. You know, a huge audience to make a lot of money with advertising. I said, the way you make money on YouTube is if you sell your own product. You don't need nearly as many. So then we had a great conversation about that. Now that I would support 100%. You know what I'm saying? Like, if we could sit down and do that together, and that'd be a nice thing, bonding, you know, thing.
Right. That makes me think too, because I actually had a conversation with my oldest, and he's only 7, but you know, he loves just building Lego. Like, he just creates now. He's in a place where he just like can create something new every day. And he actually asked me about like videoing that and like having one a day. So if I just had him showing that, you know, and like that's totally something valid. People could watch this timeline
and
progression.
It's feeding into his passion, right? Yeah, like I could totally see, like, I could totally do that. Yeah. I could totally get behind, you know, if I had a kid who had a passion for something that they really liked. Like, to me, and that's what it's really like, I think that's part of our jobs as parents, right? I'm not one, but if I was a parent, I think is to find the things that your kids are passionate about and they love, and then helping support that. And maybe that's a way of doing that, like you're bringing up right now. I think that would be, I bet it would draw lots of attention too. I think lots of people would follow, because we've already seen some of these kids, they get huge followings from unwrapping presents or building certain Lego things. And, you know, maybe it's a timeline video or, you know, check out this cool thing that I made out of Legos or whatever, you know, but it's something he loves to do. He's passionate about, a way that he can build whether it be a reputation or a following, whatever you want to fucking call it. Mm-hmm. You know, it allows him to have access to something that maybe we would consider denying him or her because they're too young or we don't think that's right. When in reality, we are in the middle of watching this huge shift of that being very much so the norm, to the point where, you know, a job like ours, here we are, we just hired 2 employees on. And I tell you what, if we had somebody equally talented as the 2 young men that we brought on staff, but the other two applicants had 50,000 Instagram followers, I think each of us would agree that we probably would hire the one with, if all things were equal, right? Their talents were equal, what they could bring to the table, but because they had this large social presence and our job, our business, definitely that would help it. I think a lot of businesses would benefit from large networks and followings of employees. Imagine if you're a bar owner and you had, and this is what the thought that came to me is like, man, I'm hiring a total of 10 bartenders are going to work at my bar. Of course, they have to serve drinks. They need to have that skill set. Hopefully, they're attractive people, charismatic. All those things matter. But man, if all eight bartenders that I hired all had 10,000 followers or above, like what would that potentially do for my business?
I actually already, I was watching something. I don't know if it was a documentary, but they're talking about like old bands and how they used to travel, you know, and like book all these gigs. And like, I think it was somewhere in Australia, but like they're talking about like all this guy does now for promotions. Like he doesn't work with like Aerosmith and, you know, all these like big name bands anymore. He completely just focuses on these people that bring have a million following, or, you know, a couple hundred thousand following. 'Cause then it's like insanely predictable. People show up every single time when these internet celebrities come to town, and it's like made him like 10x'd his business.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
Which is crazy, but it makes perfect sense.
Also, I wonder how much it's going to change. You know what I mean? Like as that becomes the way celebrities are created, because it's starting to become like that, right?
Right,
it's,
right.
It's starting to become like pretty soon Hollywood and music and all that stuff is going to be... celebrities aren't going to come from there. It's going to be all through these type of mediums. Mm-hmm. I wonder if that's going to make it more difficult to kind of build a brand like
that.
Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, oh, yeah. To shine that's, it when everybody's
okay,
putting it on
again,
them.
Yeah. This is what brings me to this thought. Like, you know, and I think the longer that we hold our kids back from them being able to do that, the further behind they're going to be, because I think it's going to be very competitive. I think that, and think of that from a job perspective, I think that literally you're going to look at eight bartenders, but I'm looking at 20 bartenders. I only need eight. All of them are good, but these ones have this big of a presence, like they're getting hired. You know, it's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer that I'm going to hire them because of that. And that obviously that's just one example I'm using. And I think that it applies to many jobs out there.
I guess a lot of it just depends on what you're doing with that. You know what I mean? How you built your page. Like if it's just, if there's something, you know, something behind it besides just, you know, the way you look, unless you get into a field related to that. But I could imagine, like, imagine a girl who's got an Instagram page with 100,000 followers and it's all because she's showing off her body. And then she's like, I want to become a lawyer or I want to become a doctor. Like that might do the opposite. I don't know. It might do the exact opposite.
Absolutely.
Like,
and this is part of the tie. I think as a parent, I think these are the type of conversations that you're helping your young kid, you know,
try and steer them too.
Right, exactly. Yeah, instead of like holding it away from him, not letting him exposing him early, but then teaching him early on that, you know. So
well, you'd be surprised. You hold them back as much as you want. My kids teach me shit about.
I know. Yeah.
They know more than I do about uploading videos and already, and they don't even have their own channels.
Yeah.
But I think it would be a good thing. I'm like I said, I've already thought about doing this. I'm not pushing it, but I'd like to work with my kid and have them create something. Even if it doesn't work, which the odds of course are probably won't, but the amount of, you know, learning you get from that process. Imagine starting your own business at that age through these, you know,
it would
these
be
channels.
Really cool.
Well, yeah, I mean, just got my wheels spinning already just from what Justin said. Imagine if like your boy is really good at this and like a lot of people start following.
I was thinking about that. And I was like, that's not a bad idea.
Right. And opens the door for him to potentially, I mean, you could teach him how to make money before the kid's even like 16 years old. He
partner
could,
with Lego.
Right. You know, right. And as stuff, a dad who has a lot of pull in this arena, I mean, you may be able to provide an opportunity for him and teach him at the same time, right? You could give him a lesson in business.
Yeah, if he wants it. Yeah.
Right,
so
right.
Obviously. Yeah,
right,
but,
right.
Yeah.
So anyways, that was that was one of my hiking high thoughts that I had that I thought I'd share with you guys and see what you thought.
Sparked an interesting conversation.
Not that at all that I disagree with you. I just thought that it would be, I knew it was challenging for me to think about it. I couldn't imagine how challenging it has to be for fathers like you guys to have to.
Yeah, I don't think a lot of people have even thought about this kind of stuff yet.
Right, and that's why I wanted to bring it up, because I bet you there's a ton of parents that are just like no or yes about it, and they don't really think all the way through.
I think a lot majority of parents, you get a lot of the no's, and then a lot of parents are just that don't care.
Yeah,
I don't even think it's
a
yes.
Disconnect. Yeah,
they just don't care. Yeah, they just let their kids do whatever.
Right, I think
is bad no matter what.
Right,
you know what I mean, you leave your kids and just be like you don't give a shit.
Yeah,
doesn't matter what
that's
they
never
do.
Worked.
It's probably not a good thing. You know what we forgot to mention was. Don't we have like an email coming out or something people need to register for, Doug? What do we got going on?
Yeah, this Thursday we're having a flash sale.
Oh,
kaboom!
It's a surprise.
It's going to be a surprise.
Not so, like Sal flashing in front of the red lights.
Right. So if you want to get notified about the flash sale, you need to sign up for the 30 days of coaching.
Okay, so
if you haven't already done that, then do that.
So go to mindpumpmedia.com and just sign up for it.
Exactly.
And then we're going to send out an email for a one-day flash sale.
And some people that have been listening for a long time, I've just had something that I didn't even know you guys have this. So the 30-day, it's free coaching. So it's 30 days of free coaching. So it's not like it's some gimmick where we're trying to sell you something or whatever. It's completely free. Sign up for it. I think everybody should have access to it. And then if you're on that list, you're automatically on our mailing list, and then Doug will send that out next week, which is cool. We also need to mention too, our sponsors, Organifi, just sent their cool shipment.
We got a ton of boxes, man.
Yeah, we got all kinds of good stuff, which Doug brought up something this weekend I think would be a brilliant idea. I know we haven't completely solidified exactly what we're going to do, but maybe now that we have a really solid, good sponsor like Organifi, that we do some sort of a giveaway with them, like we have done with the t-shirts. I think that would be a brilliant idea.
Well, if you're on the fence to try it out, this would be a good way.
Why don't we do like where they do a post or something and they do some kind of hashtag?
Yeah, I think we should discuss exactly like how we lay it out. But Doug brought that up this weekend, and I thought that would be fucking really cool. We've already done something for the reviews on iTunes. I think doing some sort of a giveaway with, like you're saying, Instagram or something like that. But we'll figure that all out. We'll put it together. But if you guys haven't tried out the Organifi, and I can't wait. We just got the red juice in, which I haven't tried yet. I've been on using the green juice, it's been a tradition now. Every weekend we're starting to
make. I saw you made those green
pancakes. Yes, the mint chip pancakes. I love it because I get the protein inside of it. Plus I get and I'll be the first one to admit that on Sunday morning breakfast, not a lot of greens are typically in my morning breakfast, and I also get a late start, like at noon. By the time we're 11 to noon,
you just eat the pancakes just like that by themselves.
Pancakes, and I have a little bit of syrup on them, and then I have my my bacon with it.
I wonder how they would taste if you put butter in them and rolled them up, ate them like that.
Oh, they would be bomb. Although those ones, I think the magic is in the mint flavor with the dark chocolate chips. So it has we did them by themselves, and they were all right by themselves. But I was like, yeah, they have this, you know, pancakes aren't supposed to have this minty flavor to them. So it is different. If you're going to have pancakes and you want traditional pancakes, it's different. But if you put the chocolate chips, you get these like mint chocolate chip flavor when you're having pancakes.
Right, I'll make them this week.
That's killer. Doug, bring on the burn.
This Quah is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
Our first question is from Peyton Cannon. Would different styles of CNS training such as Isometrics and Plyos be good for trigger sessions?
Hell yeah, absolutely. So trigger sessions...
Just be careful not to...
Yeah, we'll get into that. So
yeah, especially with Plyos.
So trigger sessions, for people that don't know, a trigger session are these kind of mini... I hate to call them workouts because they're not meant to be workouts, but mini sessions that you do on your off days. And the goal of the trigger session is to maintain the muscle building signal from the previous day, which was set with the heavy workout. Typically, they're about 8 minutes long. The goal is to get a little bit of a pump in the muscle, a little bit of a burn. And you do them frequently throughout the day. So you're supposed to do about three of them throughout the day. And they're extremely, extremely effective. In fact, I had not done trigger sessions consistently for a long time. I was doing other types of frequency builders. Went back to trigger sessions recently, and it always blows me away. It always blows me away by how well my body responds. Just more muscle, more body fat loss, all that stuff. Now, trigger sessions are part of a category that goes into all of our program that we call frequency builders. Okay, so trigger sessions are found in MAPS Anabolic, but like in MAPS Aesthetic, we have focus sessions, which are similar but different. In MAPS Performance, we have mobility sessions. And in MAPS Anywhere, we have what are called AMP sessions. And what they are is they are designed to give you more frequency to your workouts. And the goal with that, with the frequency, is also to minimize damage to muscle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because you're adding these to your already kind of almost complete intense routine. So if you're doing like 3 days a week of full body, well, now you have, you know, another three or four days a week that you can add frequency. But because you've already had three hard full body workouts, you don't want to necessarily tear muscle down. You just want to throw in some frequency. So that's how I would treat them if you did isometrics and plyos. On those days in between, don't do them super intense, but just train the sequence, train the the recruitment pattern.
I was definitely going to reiterate that because, you know, you definitely want it for that fact. You want it for the frequency of stimulating your body to produce those types of movements or that type of response from your central nervous system. But you should be, for instance, with plyometrics, if your goal is to get really powerful and explosive in those jumping type movements, that should make its way in high intensity, within your workout. The ones in between, we want to keep that reasonably light. So that's more if you're using it for like the frequency of it, because you going from, heavy max lifting days, not max lifting, but you know what I mean? Like foundational days, like three times a week. And then in between, if you're doing super explosive, high intensity plyometrics, we're going to get some diminishing returns.
How do you feel about, Justin, since this is kind of your area, what about instead of doing plyos like you normally would, where you're just trying to explode, what if on the trigger session days, you're just trying to perfect your technique and your
minimal
patterning?
Reps, exactly. So, I mean, you obviously want to
just like practice.
Yeah, it's to get fast with it, because really what you're trying to do is get more acceleration. So your ground forces play into effect, right? You have to be able to get that coiled response and then get as much acceleration as possible. But like you're doing it in such a way where, there's not a whole lot of reps you're doing in a row. You're really perfecting the signal of that and honing in on it. Mm. So that's like your focus.
Isometrics would be perfect. That'd probably be the best.
Yeah, for sure.
I feel like the answer is obviously yes, but I think that how I would decide this would be based off my goal, right? So, I think using triggers with isometric, okay, I'll show you how I would use like isometric, plyo, and then our traditional way that we use it. If I am more aesthetic based and I am areas that I'm trying to develop on my body, like I want better biceps or better shoulders, I'm sticking more towards the traditional way that we have incorporated trigger sessions, where I'm just standard bicep and shoulder type movements to get that added frequency and added pump and more recovery, all the benefits we talk about. If I am trying to correct something like a bad recruitment pattern that I have, or for example, for me, the retraction depression of my shoulders, I think I would incorporate, I'm really trying to work on an imbalance maybe that I have and address some issues. I would probably use the trigger sessions for isometrics. I would do a lot of isometric stuff and be treating it kind of like our fortification sessions that we have inside of Prime. So, and then lastly, if I was like an athlete or even if I wasn't like a professional athlete, but I play basketball on the weekends, or I'm playing sports still and I want to improve upon my explosiveness and some of the stuff Justin was just talking about, I think I'm using my triggers, plyos in my triggers. So to me, my goal that I'm trying to achieve is what would dictate how I'm using these triggers. And I think absolutely the answer is yes, you can use all those things, but I also think that I would prioritize them around whatever my priority is, out of those.
For sure. Like you want to be like, you want it to benefit whatever goal you have going into it. And I think from, just thinking of it too, like explaining like isometrics, how I'd use that in more of a performance related goal. Like I want to make sure that I'm going to use this more to teach my body to get super, super comfortable in depth or ranges of motion that I know I'm going to express on the field. Or so now I want to solidify my force stabilization. So if I get like lateral forces, I really want to solidify the fact that I'm stable. And so that's one way I'll use it too from a sports perspective. And then the other, like I mentioned, depth, or like in my squat, you know, I really want to hone in on the weakest part of my lifts, and then you know, get that signal super strong going in.
I wonder if this person is an athlete. Did you happen to look at their?
I didn't.
Okay.
No. Isometrics, by the way, one of the most overlooked, underrated types of training. Period.
Like, I love that we talk about, especially Justin, and of course with the Axon stick, because
it's so underrated.
Yeah, that and frequency, I think, are two big things that I incorporate now in my 30s that I never really did in my early 20s, just because lack of information and knowledge in the area, and I didn't realize what a difference.
You know who benefits? You know who benefits 10 to
15
a lot?
15 degrees of strength from the joint. So in either direction. So
it's huge.
That's
besides performance, because you're seeing athletes.
Where did you get that right there? Where did that come from?
Some studies.
Bunch of studies.
Saying that, sharing them. So basically, it can increase the joint mobility by 10 to 15 degrees? Or are you strength. Saying 10 to 15% strength?
Yeah. Wow. It carries over 10 to 15 degrees.
Wow, that's a big difference.
Yeah. So whatever isometric position you're strengthening, you actually gain strength in a broader range. So isometrics is today being used more by, I think, athletes, you're starting to see. But you know who benefits a lot from isometrics that don't use, and they don't use them at all? Bodybuilders.
Oh yeah.
Bodybuilders could have.
Well, they do in their posing.
But not like the way you should use isometrics, right? Isometrics are phenomenal for bodybuilders, primarily because bodybuilders almost never in their training, except for maybe the squeeze, do they ever stop a position in or a rep? You don't, like, for example, when you see a bodybuilder do shoulder press, it's always kind of this pumping motion, and I know why, because they want the pump, they want the burn. But you give them some heavy dumbbells, have them lock out and hold with tension for time, and watch what happens to the development of their delts. I mean, it's a training tool that doesn't cause a lot of muscle damage.
Yeah.
So the good thing about that is you could just throw it in. You can throw in some isometrics to your routine and watch what happens. And the old timers used to do them all the time. I mean, the old bodybuilders of, you know, back in the day used to talk about, you know, holding the squeeze for long periods of time. That was primarily how they used them. But even before that, isometrics was a staple. And I can't think of, there's very few things I can think of that you could just add to your routine that are going to give you like pretty traumatic results. Isometrics is one of them. So I just want to make sure I say that, because it's one of those, you know, overlooked things.
Definitely.
Quick commercial break, you guys. We keep getting asked all the time, how can I support the Mind Pump family? Here's one of the best ways you guys can. You guys love that Chimera coffee that we have. Chimera coffee with a K. You go to chimeracoffee.com, put in the discount code MINDPUMP for 10% at the checkout. If you guys have not tried Ben Greenfield's new bars out, they're fantastic. If you want some, go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/naturebite. Put in the code MINDPUMP and get 10% off. Go check it out.
Next question is from Joseph X95. Sal talked about how good he was at working the floor. Can you guys share some of your tactics that made you successful?
So he's talking about
work that floor. Yeah, Sal.
He's talking about as a personal trainer.
Wearing his high heels.
Yeah, exactly. Working the floor is when you are literally on the gym floor and you're trying to build your business through it by getting clients. Okay. So one of the easiest things I can tell you, to become successful at working the floor, is learn how to use the front desk. The easiest place in the world on the floor, and the front desk is part of the floor, at getting clients, is the front desk, because people walk in, you check them in, instant connection, instant ability to be able to talk to them, ask them questions. The second thing I could say to you is learn how to use your intercom over the loudspeakers. If your gym allows you to, and if you do a good job, they'll want you to use the intercom on a regular basis, because a very, very quick, easy, well-done announcement, you know, attention members and guests, we have 5 free personal training sessions available at the front desk, going on a first-come, first-served basis. Come book them up here with Justin, you know, before they're gone. And within 20 minutes, you'll have 5 assessments booked.
Super effective, yeah.
Super easy. Those two things alone, super easy. They don't require you to be, like, you know, crafty with how you approach people. You know, we'll talk about that too, but that requires more skill. Like, I'd have trainers just sit at the front desk and scan people, and I'd tell them, when you scan people, ask them what they're working on. mm-hmm. that day. Mm-hmm. You know, like, hey, what are you working on today? Oh, I'm going to do a little legs. Oh, awesome. What the exercise? Oh, let me show you this new exercise. And just walk back with them and take them through a couple exercises, and you've got your intro right there. Very, very easy.
I think a lot of people struggle with this because of the pressure of trying to make the sale. You know, is they're like, okay, I got to go talk to people on the floor.
That's a great point.
And I've got to make this sale. So there's this pressure in the back of your mind that, like, the whole purpose of why you're talking to this person is to eventually sell them on personal training. And, you know, I actually, and it wasn't until I think after Justin, so I don't think Justin ever experienced with me teaching my trainers this, but this was something I started to put together later on as I realized how many trainers struggle with this. Because they put so much pressure on themselves. They're already not very charismatic and outgoing. And then on top of that, their boss is telling them to walk the floor and go pull people off the floor and sell them training. And it was just like, it was so daunting. And because I'm a numbers guy and I would track all the stats on how many people I would need to talk to before I could book X amount of appointments that would turn into X amount of dollars, I would teach this process to somebody. So I would give a simple goal like this. I'd have a trainer. And I say, okay, get yourself one of those little journals that you get from CVS for, you know, $2 or whatever. And you're going to meet 5 people today. And I don't want you to try and sell them anything. All I want you to do is to meet them, say hi, introduce yourself, and find out something about them, anything, whether it be the surgery they just recently did, how many children they have, their wife, thing, their job, whatever it is. Your goal is just to talk to them and actually find out one thing about them. No pressure to sale. Don't book them an appointment. None of that stuff. That happens. It happens. But your goal right now is just to meet people. But then I would tell them, as soon as you meet that person and you learn something about them, their name and something about them, I want you to walk back over to where my office was, write in the journal, okay, I just met Justin. He has 2 boys, ages this and this, and then we'll go back on the floor. And so you would do that and you would gather that. And so I would make these trainers and the reason why I'd make them write it down was because I knew that if they didn't, they would probably forget some of this information. Plus I'm setting them up for later on. So once they would do this, they would start to build this list. After a couple of weeks of doing this, they'd have a list of, you know, 30, 50, some of them 100, depending on how active you are, of people with all these names and something to remind you about them. And then the next time you saw them come in, you'd go over, reference your journal, Justin, 2 boys. And then your goal would be to go over there, walk up, say hi, and mention that fact that you learned about that person. What that does for you, that person will be blown away that you remembered their name and you actually remembered something about them. Now, some people are gifted and have a natural skill of doing this. Sal would be an example of somebody has this incredible memory and talent and charisma to do this without it. But what I learned as I was managing all these trainers was Sal is 1 in 100 people that I get to, if that, actually probably more like 1 in 1,000,000. There's very few people that have his talent. And so I
had a big head now.
I had to learn.
I take off my headphones.
I had to learn to teach this skill set to people that did not have this natural charisma and ability. And I had a lot of success with what I'm telling you right now. So they would go in and they would do that. It is much easier to ask for money from somebody who you've built in a relationship with before. And I used to love this quote I used to keep on my desk. Nobody cares how much you know until they know how much you care. So you may have all this found knowledge in fitness and nutrition and all this great stuff to give to them to then turn around and get them to buy from you. But if you first show them how much you care, asking for that money or being able to provide that service for them becomes very easy for you to do, but you got to put the work in. And so making this list and then following up on them the next time they come in, more often than not, that second time you have that conversation with them, it's very easy to book them for a free appointment with you. If you still have a challenge, that's okay. Then you work that lead and you talk to them a third time and a fourth time. But if you're actually strategic about it and you actually take the time to write this stuff down, you'll solidify it in your brain so you remember better. You'll have something to reference because I guarantee you, you're going to see faces that, fuck, I forgot his name. I forgot his kid's name. You'll forget those things because how many people you talk to inside a gym. And if you start to do that, it'll make your job a lot easier.
Quick question, because something's dawning on me right now. When did you leave 24 when you were managing the gyms?
What year?
Yeah.
Let's see here. Let's back up 2011 or 12, somewhere around
there. So you know what's dawning on me? I haven't managed a gym, a big box gym, in a long time, and the people that were working out with headphones on, almost impossible, very difficult to approach them. Is that increased? It has to, right?
I'm sure.
I don't think anybody listens to the
overhead music anymore.
Is it like that now? It is, isn't it?
I don't know if it's...
When you go to Gold's, are a lot of people just in their shit?
Like, yeah, but I don't know if that's any different than what it was before. I feel like they're more obvious because it's very popular. It's popular
to have... DJ'd.
Yeah, right? Walkman and Discman have been around for a long time and people have been listening to music while they work out.
You know why I'm asking is because now it's on your phone.
Remember Discman, like trying to work out with that piece of shit?
Skipping.
I remember if we changed the music in the gym and people don't like it, we'd get... People would be pissed.
Oh, yeah. I don't think people
do people even care anymore?
Yeah, they do. That still exists. They do? That still exists. Okay. And there's still people that don't wear headphones. I mean, there's
old-timey people.
I don't know.
You just walk up to them and unplug their shit.
It's probably increased. It's probably increased and does make that challenging. I think for sure. Which again, I think would make it even more important for you to do something like this because nobody wants to be interrupted when their headphones are in their ear and then also try to be sold something.
I think what you guys both said is on point. This reminds me of like when didn't we have to wear a yellow shirt at one point? Okay. So,
what?
Yeah, Adam had us wearing.
Whoa, don't say Adam. That was a company.
Yeah, it was brought down from you. I don't know.
Let me tell you what they did because I remember before and after. So, the trainers used to have what were called fit hours that everybody had to work. Sal, you remember this, where a trainer was allotted a certain amount of time every week where he would work the floor or do fit appointments, free appointments where people would come in and they would test drive a trainer. Well, you would have this 4-hour block. What they wanted was if you didn't have a client, if you didn't go and book somebody in with you and you had a free hour, you would put on this yellow jersey and work the floor. And it said, I'm a trainer, need help.
Which
and
they made it easier in a sense for like these people that had a hard time. They basically gave him a baby shirt.
Yeah,
you
know, super cheesy. Only lasted about a year.
I'll tell you what though, knowing me, if someone came up to me and asked me for help,
I took advantage of it.
I was like,
all day. Really? And that's the thing. Like this is coming from me. This has been more of a challenge, than the both of you. But at a certain point, I'm very much of an observer, and so just being around people that have this sort of rapport with people, I would constantly watch the way that people would interact, with other trainers and management and all that, and so I would actually naturally just picked up a lot of those things that you guys mentioned. Like I figured out that I'm just gonna talk to them about whatever's on the TV or whatever, and it'll naturally I'll just remember the conversation I had, and then I would bring up the conversation related to that subject and I would talk to them again about it. But then I evolved and learned to kind of hang out around the front desk, and instead of just sitting there, I looked and saw whoever's name it was, and I would actually take their card, scan them in, like repeat their name back to them, and then before they left, I made sure and said their name as they're leaving, so that way we still maintain that connection going forward. But it's a lot of those things. You just have to you have to immerse yourself in it and go 100%. Even if it's like uncomfortable for you, you need reps, and it starts with the lowest barrier to entry. Mm-hmm. So however you can figure that out to start, to break that ice that you have in front of you, that's where you need to focus.
I'm telling you, the front desk is like gold. I cannot believe it's easy. I can't believe how many people don't realize that. That was people used to fight in my gyms over the front desk, and I'd schedule them.
I lived there, man.
That's where you park. You park yourself at the front desk. You check people and you say, hi, what's up, John? What's up? Hey, what are you working on today? I'm hitting this.
Yeah, and then you make friends with all the sales counselors and everybody. Dude, that way they feed you.
If you're a trainer that wants to grow your business, you need to live around the front desk and say hi to everybody that walks in. Ask them what they're working on. Don't try and sell them shit. By the way, what Adam says about the pressure about trying to sell something, your goal, if you do have a goal, which sometimes you don't, sometimes your goal is just to say hi to people and talk to people, which is good. If your goal is anything, to get anything, it's to schedule an assessment or a free session, not to sell training. The odds of selling training off the floor are very, 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 very low, and only the best people tend to do that. And what I mean by the best is not that you're the best salesperson, but there's a certain type of sensitivity that you have with communication to know whether or not, because nobody wants to be bothered while they're working out to buy something. So you got to kind of know what you're doing there. So don't even worry about that. Just book assessments, talk to people. But yeah, that front desk, man, park your ass up there. That's money.
Right? I know some people are not going to like this, but I mean, I also believe in complete transparency in our show. And so one of the things that I used to do, and I was notorious for this, I would actually hang out at front desk at certain gyms because you could actually see the parking lot. And other times I would hang out in the parking lot. No. And if I saw somebody pull up in a 7 Series,
you knew your whales were.
Yeah, that's right. If I saw someone pulling up in a $100,000 whip, the likelihood of them investing in, you know, a few thousand dollars in personal training is probably more likely than the guy. Now, that's not to say that I haven't sold plenty of training to somebody who drove up in some beater, but if you want to increase your odds on money not being a major an objection to, which, let's be honest, the number one objection you will hear in sales will always be money. And so you're less likely to hear I can't afford $300 or $500 worth of personal training when the guy or girl pulls up in a, you know, $100,000 whip. So I would actually see that person come in, and then I'd be at the front desk and I'd scan them in. So I'd see their name, say hi to them then, and then I'd make sure to go out to the floor and say hi to them again on the floor. And so I used to do stuff like that all the time.
Nice to see you, Stuart Smith III. What are you going to be training today? How was your pole lesson?
Is that a family crest that you have embroidered? Oh, that's great.
Next question is from Connie Sue. Do you have any experience with clients with eating disorders?
This is all trainer day today, dude.
What kind of advice do you have? I love it.
I mean, most people I think you'll work with as a trainer, if you're a really good trainer, you understand nutrition really well. Most people have some type of eating, some type of eating dysfunction. I don't want to say disorder, because clinical disorder would be like bulimia, anorexia, or some type of OCD. But most people have some type of eating dysfunction that you're going to have to work around. Now, I have worked with real eating disorders. I've worked with a few of them. Most of them, all of them but one, actually were working with a therapist in conjunction with me.
This is a hard one, by the way.
Very hard. Mm. One of them I trained, I was very, very, I was on to her. Like, I knew she had an eating disorder, but you can't just come out and say you have an eating disorder.
Yeah, super delicate.
Yeah, and so I would, you know, sprinkle in some conversations, some questions. I talk a lot about myself. People are much more apt to open up to you when you're open with them. So I would talk about my own issues with food. You know, I talk about how I always thought I was skinny and I would force feed myself and I would, you know, set my alarm to wake up in the middle of the night and to take a protein shake or whatever. And how I had, you know, I told her, I said, you know, I had an eating disorder. I just didn't realize it. I said, but I know how difficult it can be for people to even acknowledge that they have that issue, and it was incredible. It took me this long.
So you got to stop right there, because that is something that I used to teach that I think is a lost art, and not a lot of people understand the importance of what you just did right there. It's so, and doctors, good doctors do this really well, right? You come in, you get this, you find out you've got something or you have something that sounds so bad because you've never heard it. And a really good doctor does a good job of letting you feel like it's very normal and common and don't worry. This is how we handle it. This is how we take care of it. The same thing goes for as a trainer who is getting this new client in that has an eating disorder or is struggling with obesity or has something that's a challenge. The last thing you want them to feel is make them feel like they're all alone in that and that it's very uncommon or, oh my God. So by you sharing your own, you know, eating disorders or a poor food relationships makes them at ease. And like, so I would tell trainers that when clients give you information like that, or you assume they have something like that, make them feel like almost everybody struggles with this in one way or another. Almost everybody deals with some sort of a food. That way it helps them be at ease a little bit and more likely to share more information with you and more likely to work towards getting better at it. And I think that's such a good point.
With this particular client that I suspected had either anorexia or bulimia or one of those two, because she was just, you can tell as a trainer, you can start to see in the gym who has these extreme issues because there's the obvious physical symptoms. And there's other symptoms that, you know, you can look out for. And we were training and her strength wasn't very good, and we stood up from an exercise, and she got really dizzy. And so we sat down and I said, what have you eaten today? And she told me, you know, oh, I ate this and that. And I said, okay. I said, I want you to know that you could always be totally, totally honest with me with what you're doing. It'll only help me train you better. If you can be honest with me with everything, with what you're eating or what you're not eating, then I can be a much more effective personal trainer because I know you have particular goals. And then she started kind of opening up with her nutrition. And the thing really with her was I had to slowly get her to divulge the information. Yeah. I did not say you have an eating disorder. I did not say, oh, that's called bulimia and anorexia or whatever. Mm-hmm. It was very little. And then I slowly talked her into, okay, eat, you know, buy yourself these small packets of almonds. Make sure you eat that before you work out. That'll prevent you from getting dizzy. And that's a good thing because then we can train a certain way and you can build more muscle and, you know, you could maintain your leanness better. And little by little, I talked her to that point to where I finally was able to have more frank discussions with her. And she did go and see a therapist, but it was a long process. But most of the people you're going to work with, if you're a really good trainer, you're going to find that everybody has some kind of eating dysfunction. Mm-hmm. You'll know right away when you tell your client, you can't eat this anymore. Or, you know what, let's stay away from this food. And all of a sudden they freak out. You know?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, what do you mean I can't?
Or how long do I have to do that for?
Right? Yeah. I mean, it's just...
Very few people are going to just come forward and tell you they have a disorder or an issue with food like this. It's real similar to talking to an alcoholic or someone addicted to drugs. Rarely ever have you ever met somebody who is addicted to something like that and they go like, yeah, I'm totally addicted to drugs. I have a problem with that. I know that. Like, very few people admit it. And that's the first step, right, of getting through this process is admitting it. So I think your goal as a trainer is to make them feel comfortable enough to share that they have an issue. You know, you're going to probably know before they share it with you. Your goal still, even when you know, is not to call them out. That's the worst thing you could do, because then they're going to put them in denial, and yeah, then you're probably going to be fighting an uphill battle.
Yeah, and they're not even going to know most of the time. That they're not going to realize that, yeah, you know, like these habits are unhealthy for them. It's just like eye-opening, and so there's resistance to that because of the information that they've you know, aligned themselves with, like, since they're a kid, right? Like, all this nutrition information. If you add something that, you know, contrasts that at all, it's like, what? It's a really hard pill to swallow sometimes.
So I used to like share stories of other clients as if to that person, but I'm really talking to them.
Sure.
So for example, like, let's say we're talking to somebody who has anorexia and I know she's battling with this, but she hasn't fully admitted to me. I'm like talking to her like, yeah, I know, I get lots of clients that have this. In fact, I had this lady who's struggling with this, and I'm like sharing the patterns and the things that I know that she has, that she's that she's dealing with. So I'm really talking to her about her, but I'm acting as if I'm talking about, like, mm-hmm, lots of these clients that I've trained before or this particular person that I've
just
had before.
Just examples that they can, yes, at least kind of identify with on some level.
And that's
that
what I'm
deflects off of them.
Right. Yeah. I'm trying to, you know, like that old, you know, hey, I have a question for a friend of mine. You know, like,
yeah.
You know, I have a friend of mine that's really interested in this. It's like that type of deal, right? They know what it wants to admit it's them. So it's kind of like you advising them, yeah. And that kind of helps ease them into that, you know, starting to share with you and ask more questions because they feel that their issue or what they're struggling with, they're not alone in it. Lots of people deal with it.
Yeah. And I'll say this. I want to be very clear. If we're talking about a diagnosable clinical eating disorder and you identify it, your goal should be, obviously, you're open with them, you're talking with them, but see if you can get them to talk to a professional that deals with that.
Sure.
Because you as a personal trainer are not trained in this area. And now that I'm thinking about it, many of the personal trainers themselves may have some, you know, eating dysfunctions, and they might not be the best people to talk to or to talk with these, you know, these clients.
Although I believe the person who's asking this question is already a better trainer, just
probably,
for already wanting to know advice on how to handle it. So good point.
Quick commercial break. Hey, people ask us all the time how they can support Mind Pump. Here's what you can do. You can go to www.brain.fm/mindpump and get 20% off Brain FM for meditation or focus. You can also go to audibletrial.com/mindpump and get a 30-day trial plus one free audio book. Lastly, you can go to getnatureblend.com/mindpump and you will get a discount on Ben Greenfield's CBD product.
Next up is Garrett Morales. Justin, how does being a mind pump compare to being in a band?
Oh, man, that's an awesome question. It's like so rad. Yeah. Dude, there's so many comparisons. I mean, where do I begin?
Yeah. Is it really?
There's like apparel. You know what I mean? There's like,
at what point
everybody has like their own sort of vibe they're bringing in, you know, to the creativity process.
Clash of egos.
Oh my God. Like, yeah, somebody always has a huge one, and then like somebody else kind of comes in like, no, man, I wrote that song. Like, oh shit, you're right. You know, like half the time it's really funny because I know like it resembles a lot of that sort of like team, that group flow kind of dynamic, and something that we really have. And it's funny because it's total chemistry thing. Like some people can work out, some people can't work out. Like sometimes I've tried to, and I've jammed with certain people and it just sounds like dog shit. And like somebody doesn't have the right rhythm, you know, somebody's like contributing like this weird like scale and you're like, why would you throw that in there? That's fucking lame, bro. You know? And like, you know, the drummer, he's like doing his own little groovy thing and you're just like, no, dude, pick it up, you know? And so it's just like, it's just this interesting like kind of blend of chemistry that sometimes you just hit, you know, the group hits and it's like it's fucking gold and you know you make like killer music, but like it's so rare. And I feel like, you know, like it, you know, not to be like, you know, we're so awesome, but we are, so, you know, this chemistry thing, you know, like it's rare to get that. So it's a pretty cool thing to think about, because I tried so hard to make that happen with the band, you know, like we were just like, dude, you know, maybe we just got to work harder or we just got to get our big break, you know.
That's a good question. Did you feel like, you know, that whole process of trying to build a big band, that was, you had to work really hard at it, where this felt like there was no working towards it. It was just, could you distinguish the difference?
100%. Like that's, I mean, nailed it. Like the actual music we were making was interesting and I was like into it at the time. Like I was like, wow, this sounds cool. And it was like really fun and we were having a whole lot of fun, but there was no business to it and there was no management to it. And it was all an afterthought. And like, I was the only one that even had a job, you know? And so I'm like buying all the equipment and the trailer and all this shit and trying to book us gigs. And that was just like a one-sided thing. It was like, I just got burnt out. And like, you know, once I kind of was like, dude, this is fun and all, but like, I'm burnt. Like I got to get back to reality where I'm making money and, you know, like treating, like I got a degree for a reason. You know? It's fun, guys, but you know.
What are those guys up to now?
Actually, I stay connected to them loosely.
Did they all go off and do big things, or do some of them still chasing the, I want to be in a band one day?
One of them still is, and he was, I mean, he was definitely one of the more talented ones for sure. He was in bands before us, so we kind of absorbed him. He was our lead singer guy for a while, Andrew. He's doing stuff with a country music singer, and like this guy's getting popularity. So I hope, you know, it takes off for him. That'd be awesome.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But like he totally has shifted genres a bunch of times. So we were like heavy, heavy metal stuff, you know? And so he went from before that with like this more like kind of like popular rock, and then he got into like metal with us, and then now it's like, you know, country. So it's interesting. He writes a lot of stuff on acoustic and it's really good, but I think he still has this, you know, this dream. I think he's the only one left that's really like, you know, like, oh, music's my thing, you know, like it's so tough to break through. Like I totally respect musicians that soldier on, you know, as they get shit.
That's a long time, dude. Because it was a long time ago.
You don't make money, you know. It's not for people that want to make money. You know, it just really isn't. It's not there.
It makes me think, like, you know, because chemistry is so important for a band because you're so creative,
mm-hmm.
And so you need to have strong chemistry. But there's a potential downside of having really strong chemistry. It reminds me of like relationships, like. Guy and a girl are like super fire passionate,
mm-hmm.
and that passion can go in either direction.
It still burns out though.
Yeah, yeah. Or it burns out. Oh,
yeah,
or,
exactly.
Or
it splits.
Can, yeah, so it's like you got to be careful. You have tons of chemistry.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's times when you need to be settle and, you know, kind of keep things cool
because
it can't always be off. I don't know.
It wasn't balanced. Yeah, which I feel like this is more balanced. You know, the efforts are way more balanced, whereas it was like, just, I mean, we had like times where I was like, wow, you know, we're just like in the zone. But That was hard to recreate all the time. It still took work to recreate that, whereas like this is just so much more natural speed.
Now, because you've experienced that, do you feel like we've already kind of passed the time? As you know, is it going to be like, for example, we've been together now for, even though we've only been on air for about 2.5 years, we've really been together about 3 or so, right, that we were all kind of talking and working together. Do you feel like we've now been together doing the same thing for long enough that, okay, we've kind of lasted the time that, okay, we're going to work together, versus like maybe a band you think at first, like, oh man, right away you guys jam well.
It's, but
then,
great
you,
question.
Then you find out 6 months later, like, this motherfucker starting to get on my nerves. Yeah. Like, is that?
There's sort of a proving grounds to that, right?
Right.
Like, yeah, like you only go so long with a certain group of guys where you just realize, like, I don't know, man. I don't know if this has any weight to it. You know what I mean? And yeah, that's interesting to think about, because it's like when we were in it, like everybody just like, oh my God, we just need to get in front of people. Like, you're just so, like, you know, optimistic, and you know, you think everything's just gonna happen. And
that's like our Sal.
Yeah, yeah. No, which I love. Super. It, because I feed off of that, right? But I feel like with this, it's more like the comparison, like you've sort of mastered your instrument, right? And so have you, Sal, and so have I, right? And so we've gotten to a point where we've tried shitty bands, we've gotten through the circuits, you know what I mean? Like, we know all, like, the you know, the ins and outs of all the directions we could go, all that kind of stuff. We got a lot of wisdom, right? We've been on the road, and you know, nobody knows who we are, but then all of a sudden, you know, you just hang out, and we've all had like a similar story, and it's like, then it's the fucking Beatles.
Well, it'll be.
I had to go there.
Yeah, greatest band of all time.
It'll be interesting, because I know that we have Brianna right now, who is scheduling our roadie, and we plan on doing a nice little, you know, hit start from Northern California, work our way all the way down Southern California trip. I think that'll probably be the closest
thing. Oh, my God.
Right?
Can we sell some merch on the way, too?
Absolutely.
Like, that'll make me so happy.
I'll probably want to strangle Sal, though, that much time.
I might bring, like,
between
a guitar.
The broccoli and fucking fish inside the RV. And,
dear God.
You know, his fucking, his all natural
deodorant. Nose plugs and ear plugs.
Yeah, all natural deodorant and stuff. I think by about day 3 or so in the RV, I might be tired of this
guy. I'll be strangling you guys.
You don't want to get rid of Beyonce.
I can't wait. It's all right. Justin Timberlake will hold it down. Don't worry.
Check it out. 30 days of coaching. It's available for free at mindpumpmedia.com. Also, make sure you get on there. We have that flash sale going on. You're going to get it only through email, so we're not going to display it anywhere else. Also, go to YouTube, Mind Pump TV. We post a new video every single day. And finally, if you want to ask us a question that we answer on an episode like this one, the place to ask it on is Instagram. The page to ask it on is Mind Pump Media. We also have our own personal pages. Mine is Mind Pump Sal. Justin is Mind Pump Justin. And Adam is Mind Pump Adam.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now, plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes, and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.